Good afternoon and welcome to T.C. Williams High School. We're here in the television studio this afternoon for an unscripted televised press conference. 14 students from the journalism program are assembled here today to ask questions of former T.C. Williams head coach and head coach of the state champion 1971 Titans, Coach Herman Boone. Coach Boone had an illustrious career with the Alexandria City Public Schools, and many of us have enjoyed Remember the Titans, an award-winning movie in which he was portrayed by Denzel Washington. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce Coach Boone, who will join us today for the press conference.
Thank you very much, Mr. Eaton, for that wonderful introduction, and good afternoon, young people. And I also thank you for this once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to be back at T.C. Williams High School, the greatest high school in the country of America. And believe me, I've traveled to practically every high school and every major city in this country, and I have yet to see one high school comparable to this high school. There's one. And I remarked when I spoke there some years ago that the high school, Findlay High School in Findlay, Ohio, is about the only high school that I can say is anywhere near comparable to the powerful school of the Titans here in Alexandria. Let me congratulate all of you young students for reaching this incredible milestone of your life. I could say this program that was developed some 30-odd years ago called the K6222, you are the beneficiaries of that program, because that program brought together advanced placement courses that you so readily enjoy today. And I'm extremely happy that you have offered me the invitation to appear here for this interview. I don't know if I can answer all your questions, because but I'll try to do the best I can. So if you don't mind, let's get started so that we can get this over with and you can get back to class, okay? Yes, ma'am.
Kelly Townsend, freshman. What were your approaches to bring the 1971 team together?
Repeat that.
What were your approaches to bring the 1971 team together?
What was my approaches to bring the 1971 team together? Well, I guess it would probably take me the rest of the year to explain my approach, because my approach is not usually one that is admirable in most cases, because I'm up one side of you and a down the other side of you. I was a cusser, I was a fusser, but I was also a hugger. But I had a challenge in 1971, and obviously you are very young and don't know very much about that time of our lives. But we had three high schools in this city, and each of these high schools had their individual and separate values and whatever. They believed in the values of themselves, and they were very independent of each other. Then the school board in 1971 decided to consolidate these three high schools. Now, you may think about if you were in one of these high schools and you were the elected president of the student body, and all of a sudden Mr. Eaton and his school board members consolidated three high schools and made you guys come together as one school and one student government president and one band director and one football coach and one athletic director, one head of the English department, when you had three English departments. And can you imagine the emotions that you would have gone through? You had three football teams who didn't like one another. They were the most fierce rivalries in the state of Virginia. Football in this town was revered more lavishly than Christmas. These young people simply did not like one another. They hated each other's school colors. Now, all of a sudden, the school board said, now you got to be a Titan over my dead body. I don't want to be a Titan. I've been an admiral all my life. My mother and father were admirals. I've been a George Washington Prexy all my life. My mother and father were Prexies. I want to graduate from GW. I want to graduate from Hammond. I don't want to graduate from TC. But because of the consolidation and the changes of time, all the 11th and 12th grade students in this city had to come to TC. Now, one of the worst things happened was we got to wear TC's colors. Well, fortunately, TC Williams was the only high school out of the three that had enough football uniforms to furnish three teams of 110 to 115 students, 100 kids. Now, that in itself was very stressful to some young people. These young people had their rituals of separativeness were better developed than their rituals of togetherness. At our first 6 or 7 football game, we had three separate colors in the stands. We had the blue from Hammond, we had the gold from GW, and then we had the red from TC. People were not going to give up their loyalties to their school just that easily, just because 12 or so school board members said that we are Titans over my dead body. That mentality carried on to my football team. Now, you must know that I was not selected because they thought that I was the best football coach to be the head coach in this city. And quite frankly, you got the right one now. I was selected because I was black. Because had I not been selected as the head coach of T.C. Williams in 1971, you would have had 21 white head coaches in this city. Now, the success of this K6222 program, as was mentioned in a document that I just gave Mr. Eaton, who would probably pass it on to you, the success of this program depended on the success of this football team. So you can't imagine how the stress that I had to enjoy. I had problems from the school board. I had problems from the superintendent. I had problems from the Alexandria Sportsman Club. All of these people demanded that I bring these young people together so that we can look like we were unified, so that this program of K622 would be successful. Keep in mind, football at that time was the first program of the season. Now, had the football team in 1971 just simply lost one game, the program of the K622 would not have been successful. But by God, amid all of the controversy and all of the adversity at that time that was plagued on our souls, we found a way to bring this football team together. How do we do it? We found a way to bring this football team together by having them to talk to one another. These young people had never talked, in many cases, been in the presence of people in so many of them of a different race or different culture. Hammond was all white. TC was predominantly white. George Washington was about 75% black and 25% white. And we had a problem with integration. We had a problem with the emergence of the Black Panthers. Now, you must understand that all of this took place during some of the most stressful times in America. We were in the midst of the terrible Vietnam War. We were enjoying the Pentagon Papers, the desegregation of schools, and what they call cross-busing to integrate these schools. Even we had students who were organizing here as White Citizen Council. We had students who were organizing as Black Panthers. White kids could not go to the bathrooms on the ground floor by the cafeteria. And black kids could not go to the bathroom on the second floor and any floor above. We had some serious problems. And those problems resonated on the football team. Now, had I not gotten, in a way, this football team to come together as one team, than this whole program of K622. I believe, and it is documented by Mary Ames some 30 years ago, this whole this whole K622 integration program would not have been succeeded. Because half of the people in this city did not want that program to exist in the first place. But thanks to the dynamic leadership of a school board member, the first black school board member in the state of Virginia, Ferdinand Day, who persevered, and who demanded excellence from the school board, that program. And because he gave me the support and allowed me to take this football team to Gettysburg College so that we can live together, so we can eat together, so we can play together, and so that we can become a team. And I hope that in some way I've answered your question, but if I haven't, I think this statement will answer your question. We brought that football team together, and that football team came together because I demanded one thing of each other, and that's respect. I said to them many times, I don't care if you like each other. Heck, I don't like half of y'all. But you will respect each other to where respect becomes trust, and trust will become the emotional glue that this team needs to succeed. And success is only a word that comes in front of hard work and a dictionary. You can see I'm very emotional. And you can see that, you know, you'd rather fool around with the devil than fool around with me when it comes to respect. Because I truly believe that a team is a group of people, young people, with one vision, with one objective, and by God, one heartbeat. I don't want you to like each other, but you do have to respect people, because everybody on the face of this earth just deserves to be respected. And this is what I got out of that team. And when we took them to Gettysburg, we took them to where the seat of America was created. And we required each of these football players to visit the rooms of each person on that team every single night. Otherwise, you would not be allowed to make that football team. And talk to that. You saw it in the movie, Remember the Titans. What is your name? What is your father's name? Does your father have a job? All of that. Well, that was a part of the program of getting to know one another. I had a young man 26, 25 years later coming to me and said, Coach Boone, can I talk to you? I said, sure. He says, I've got something on my chest and I need to get it off. I said, go ahead, son. He says, I am so glad you took us to Gettysburg College, where we live together, where we work together, where we eat together, where we prayed together. Because you know what I learned at Gettysburg? I said, what? He said, I learned my parents and my father and my uncle have always taught me that black people had tails. I said, well, son, God does work in mysterious ways, doesn't he? You found out that black people did not have tails. So you were spending most of your time at Gettysburg running around in the shower looking for tails. He found that instant was not true. And he began to wonder, what else did my parents teach me that was not true, that was racially scarred? So yes, we did require, and I demanded that they come together as a team. And I believe that a team is a group of people with one vision, one objective, and you must have one heartbeat to be a team. And I said to them in Gettysburg, let me finish this. If I hear two hearts beating in this team, I'm going to kill that other sucker. Next question. Yes, sir.
Jake Hamilton, freshman. How did your players affect your coaching outside or outside of coaching?
How did my players affect my coaching outside?
Or how did they affect your life outside of coaching?
Well, I'm a coach, and a coach is many things. He's a father, he's a mentor, he's a teacher, he's many things to many people. And as my life and my values are passed on to my players, that affects them. Well, their lives and their values that they pass on to me affect me. So when this football team began to accept each other, accept the soul of each other rather than reject each other based on the color of their skin, it affected my life outside of football tremendously. Next question. And I'm going to try to make these answers much more shorter, too, because...
Christos Peterson, freshman. I was just wondering, if you could go back to when you were coaching, would you change anything you had done?
Yeah. I would make Earl Cook, our chief of police, go two ways, offense and defense. He was the greatest football player the world has ever seen. But we only played him one way defensively, and that was the greatest mistake. I don't know if anything needed to be changed, because what I think we did for the benefit of mankind, and that was cause people to celebrate their differences rather than allow their differences to become a problem to be solved in their future communities throughout their chosen communities in this country. These young men taught the world how you can overcome your fear of diversity. So I don't know if I can change anything. And maybe some people accuse me of going about it in the wrong way. I was tough. I was hard-nosed. I demanded. But there's one thing that I demand that I have never given up, given in what I believe in, and that's expectations. I expect you to be on time in your classrooms. I expect you to be respectful to your teachers. I expect you to be respectful to your parents. I expect you to be on time at your practices, and I expect you to be the very best that you can, and maybe better than best if you can. So I hope that answers your question.
Thank you
so much. Where did freshmen come from? I thought you only had juniors and seniors here. No, you have sophomores. Yes, ma'am.
Kayla Foster, sophomore. Do you consider yourself a civil rights activist?
Do I consider myself what?
A civil rights activist.
I've always been a civil rights activist. And I don't understand what you mean, active. If I believe in civil rights, because rights is something you were born with. And I will stand here and tell you I'll never let anybody take that right away from you. So if it's civil, yes, I've been a civil rights activist. I've belonged to the Urban League. I belong to the NAACP. I belong to all organizations that fought the injustice of mankind throughout my life. Yes, she was next.
Tykeer Carter, senior. I was just wondering, was the TC football team that you coached that won the championship the best team that you ever coached, or have you ever coached any other teams besides here?
The 1971 football team of TC Williams High School, young lady, was the best football team any coach will have ever wanted to coach. The 1971 football team was the most powerful football team the nation has ever seen. And I should hope that you are so proud that you have been the benefit of that team through race relations and through togetherness, even though their rituals of separativeness were better developed than their rituals of togetherness. These young men came from Gettysburg and marched throughout the state of Virginia, battling each opponent each week until they reached the pinnacle of football as a football team. I hope that answers your question. Yes, sir.
Sam West, freshman. Do you believe that Remember the Titans successfully captures the spirit of camaraderie among your team's players?
Among whom?
The team's players.
I know so. Denzel Washington, probably without a doubt to me, is one of the finest human beings on the face of this earth as a human being. He spent a great deal of time with me, and let me just take you back for a moment. Denzel Washington was not offered that role in Remember the Titans. they couldn't afford him. His basic fee was $12 million per film. The entire budget for Remember the Titans was $16 million. So he was not offered that film. A guy named Lawrence Fishburne was offered that role for $2 million, okay? But then Denzel had lunch with Jerry Bruckheimer one day and talking about another film script. And Jerry says, I want you to read this film script that I just bought. It's called Remember the Titans. And Denzel read the film strip, and he said, give me this role. I want to show the world how you can overcome your fear of diversity. I want to show the world how you can accept the soul of an individual rather than reject an individual. But I can't pay you, Denzel. True story. I can't pay you what you charge. He says, I don't care. If you make any money on the end of the film, throw me a few crumbs. God, I wish I had the crumbs he was thrown. Because last Mother's Day, that film, Remember the Titans, had grossed just the film, he called me and told me, $478 million. That does not count the CDs and the DVDs and all of that. His highest paid movie ever in the movie industry was Remember the Titans. He wanted that role so badly. He wanted to tell the world, and he came and spent two or three nights at my house, followed me around like a little lap dog, learning what I had experienced in this thing of integration here in the city of Alexandria. So Denzel wanted to tell the world, and I think he did a pretty good job. You know, we had many people who criticized the movie. One of them is a former student here who vehemently criticized the movie that, you know, you shouldn't revere the movie Remember the Titans, and, you know, Coach Boone was the worst coach in the history of football in Northern Virginia. Then why is it that that movie capitalizes the hearts and souls of people in every city in America today, every week? Why is it that movie is required in the United States Armed Forces before you can get your officer training? Why is it that movie is required by the Coast Guard? Why is it required by the Navy, Army, and Air Force so that people can learn how to respect the soul of an individual rather than reject a person based on the color of his skin? That's the essence of that movie, and that's the story that Denzel wanted to show the world. Yes, sir.
Liam Bowman, sophomore. In what ways has the movie affected your life?
Well, tremendously. I get people from all over the world want to take pictures with me. I got people all over the world want me to sign autographs so that they think that they can maintain a piece of history. And it does affect my life. I can't drink anymore because I don't want people to see me drinking. But I don't smoke anymore because I don't want kids to see me smoking. But in reality, it has affected my life tremendously. And I think that it has affected my life so that I can carry on my life in a positive manner so that I can stimulate you and I can motivate you to be the very best that you can be. You see, that movie was not made in part about my life because I look better than Denzel Washington. It was made because somebody saw that I worked hard to see to it that you young people learn to accept each other as individuals with respect and dignity, and I demanded it. So people said I was a hard-nosed coach, that I was a hard-hearted hammer and threw water on a drowning man. People said I mistreated football players. Yes, I cursed. But by God, I never cursed a child. I cursed probably for the same reason that many of your parents found a reason to curse. And I was tough on them. I had a young man named Wayne Sanders come to my house to bring his children, to introduce his children to me and say to me, this man took me out of the ghetto and sent me to Livingstone College and told me I'd better not come back until I'm successful. And I came back to let him know that I'm a colonel in the United States Army because this man demanded of us perfection. He demanded of us respect. He demanded of us, you know, to be organized. He demanded everything that the world would demand of you as an adult in this world. And I came by to say thank you. Yes, you used to fuss me out. You used to hit me on the head with a clipboard. Things that were probably coaches today would be locked up for child abuse for. I did them. I'm not proud of them. But there was a time when many of these things we had to do because many of our coaches throughout this country, like the legendary Vince Lombardi, one of the toughest coaches in this world, I had a tough job. I was not named head coach of this football team because people thought that I was the best coach in the world, and the city coach, Yost, was probably the best coach in this city. Even though the school board never knew that I had won 99 football games and lost on a 9 in my lifetime in North Carolina. The school board never knew that I had won 5 state championships in the state of North Carolina prior to coming to here in 1969. They didn't care. I was the only football coach in this city, black football coach in this city, that had head coaching experience, and they plucked me out of this group of adversity and made me the coach. Hope I answered your question.
Thank you.
Yes, ma'am.
Claire Bilodeau, sophomore. What role did you play in the development of the movie script?
What role? I was there on the set every day in Marietta, Georgia. They tried to film it here at O'Connor High School. Because the plane, somewhere or another, this area is a flight pattern, and too many planes come across this school in this area so for them to film. And we were called to Marietta, Georgia, and my job was to walk around with Denzel on the set and make sure that he depicted me, make sure that he spoke with passion. Do you see me speaking with passion? Well, that's exactly how I feel, and that's exactly how I coach. I had to make sure that he spoke and he acted with passion and demanding perfection and respect. Denzel on that set did not even talk to the players on that set because he did not want them to socialize with him. He wanted them to realize that he was the coach of that team, and he demanded them to respect him as that coach. And when he walks out of the dressing room, out of his trailer, you know, those guys out there on that field, and many of them were grown people with beards. I mean, they stood up like rats on a wet floor, and they respected him because he wanted to portray what he thought that I believed in, and I believe in perfection, and I believe in respect, and I believe in dignity, and I believe in all of the values of mankind that you can give. And he wanted to portray that. And he came to my house and spent 2 or 3 days and just walking around with my wife and seeing how I talk and how I use the term, you know, you heard John Brown in the movie and your hind parts and all of that. He wanted to make sure that he got the true meaning of those things that I was brought up with. And I thought he did a pretty good job.
Thank you. Did you ever feel like quitting when you were going through the adversity that you faced as being the T.C. Williams?
I can't even spell quit. Quitting is never an option in my life or never been an option and in the life of my family. You know, one of the true, the greatest gift God could ever give any one of you kids is the ability to make a decision. And I want you to decide to persevere and never quit, never, ever quit. But when you persevere and when you win the race, don't forget to go back to the barn and take care of the horse that you rode across the finish line. You remember Diana Ross, who said, reach out and touch somebody's hand. You'll make this world a better place if you can. Would I be talking to a stone if I asked you to help someone with a problem that's not your own? If you see an old man walking down the street, do you ever believe that your shoes can fit his feet? That's the kind of person that I wanted to be. And that's the kind of person that I am today, with passion and quitting. My father used to say, when you fall flat on your face, get your butt up and get back in the race. I had a parent once named Commander Jerry Buck. His son, Jerry Buck, played right guard on that team. One day, Jerry Buck was bloody, just totally bloody in his nose and mouth, and blood was coming from everywhere. And I took him out of the game and, you know, petting him around. And Colonel Buck came down on the field and pushed him back on the field. So when you're down and out, get your butt back and get into the race. Who is Commander Jerry Buck? He's the commander that shot the Tomahawk missile for 300 miles away in Omar Gaddafi's bedroom from his ship. Died last month and buried in Arlington National Cemetery. But quitting has never been an option. Things are going to get rough. Am I allowed to tell a little story? You can never give up. There was this story about this blind man walking down the street with his seeing eye dog. And for some reason, this stupid dog took him across the street against the light. Cars were swerving all over the street to prevent hitting this blind man. And when he got across the street, he reached in his pocket and gave his dog a biscuit. This little old lady looked at him like he had lost his mind. She couldn't stand it anymore. She went up to him and said, "Sir, that dog took you into all kinds of adversity. Why would you reward that dog?" The blind man said, "Ma'am, I didn't reward my dog by giving him that biscuit. I only gave him that biscuit to find out where his head is so I can kick him dead in his butt." But the irony of that is, when you're down and out with adversity, get up and kick it right in the rear end and keep on, never, ever, ever quit. We're behind playing Marshall in 1971. We were behind 17-12 or 17-16 or something, with a minute and 5 seconds to go. Sunshine came over to me and said, "Coach, what can we do?" I said, "What do you think, son?" He said, "I think we can run 23 blasts with a backside George." I said, "You do?" "Yes." "Do you believe that?" "Yes." "Go do it." Frankie Glasgow ran 75 yards with 12 seconds left to go in that game. Otherwise, there would be no Remember the Titans, young people. There will be no Remember the Titans. If we had not come back, you saw it in the movie. They changed the name of the play, and I was up looking at Denzel someplace, and they changed the name of the play into some old messed up name. But anyway, I raised all kind of sand about it, and they called me in the trail and said, "Coach, this movie ain't about you." I said, "When you get Denzel Washington, the greatest moving actor in the world, to play me, wouldn't you think it was about me?" But nevertheless, we thought we cannot. I told you that story to tell you that there is no quitting. There is no giving up. There's no room for people who give up. Thank you. Yes, sir. About time you get up. You've been sitting there like a little quiet mouse.
Faisal Kamara, freshman. Do you still keep in contact with the 1971 Titans?
Most certainly do. And I want you to get in touch with them, because they're doing some marvelous work right here at T.C. Williams High School. They endow scholarships for kids at T.C. Williams High School, not just for 1 year, not just one donation, but they endow a scholarship for kids at T.C. Williams High School for 4 straight years. They have a foundation called the Titans Foundation. So if you, you know, you got $5, send them $5, and they'll send you a big poster of the team, and they take that money, and they give you, give a kid here a four-year scholarship. And we've got five or six kids in major colleges and universities that were sent there with the help of the Titans Foundation. So, yes, we stay in touch with each other. Riding from the airport just a few minutes ago, one of them just called me, Patches, just called me just to see how I was doing. Last night in Statesboro, Georgia, the leading dermatologist in all the state of Georgia owns 21 offices. Dr. Michael Shockey was on that team. He gave me some bad news. I said, Mike, ain't the cure for this Michael Jackson disease? He said, no, ain't no cure, coach. So tell all the people you know you're going to be white next year. So, I said, maybe it won't be so bad. I get a chance to sit in front of the bus. Next question. Yes, ma'am.
Maybe not in Rockwell freshman. How has Alexandria changed since you coached here?
Alexandria has changed quite a bit. Now, keep in mind, Alexandria to me has never been a sleepy little town as depicted in the movie. Alexandria to me has always been a metropolis, and it's always been a town endowed with free thinking people. And we've had our problems. We've had our visions of separativeness, and which were better developed in our visions of togetherness in this town. We had separate but unequal facilities in this town. We had separate but unequal schools in this town. We've had our problems. And no doubt we'll probably continue have our problems today. But Alexandria has come a long way to fight against the injustices of our children through discrimination, through inadequate budgets from the school board. Alexandria has done a marvelous job, and I am simply proud to have seen both sides of Alexandria. And I think you better thank God that you have the opportunity to live in Alexandria and go to T.C. Williams High School, the number one high school in the country, because this school board has changed its vision from separativeness to togetherness, and I think it will continue to be so. Next question.
One more question.
Yes, ma'am.
Andy Scroggs, freshman. What were some of the differences between the movie and what happened, what actually happened? What were some of the differences between the movie and what actually happened?
Well, there are only about six or seven things in the movie that we allowed them to change. Because I was there every day, and I was, you know, very vocal about what was true and what was not true. And you know, you notice the movie says now based on a true story. Well, it went there about a true story, but by the time they finished changing a few things, they said they could not say it was a true story. It was based on a true story. And there were not many things that were changed, and one of which was not true. And he always tells me to tell young people that I speak to, Sunshine will find out where I'm going to speak all over this country, and he'll call me and tell me, say, Coach, tell those students at T.C. Williams that I did not kiss Gary Bertier. So that was not true. I didn't kick, you know, Peter, the hall monitor here. Peter was the most dynamic football player in the state of Virginia. I didn't know that because Peter was from GW, and I never knew Peter. I didn't kick Peter off the offensive team. I wanted Peter on the defense where he can make a difference with his talent. He was the best football player in the country. And when you see Petey walking down the street with his little country-looking self, you're looking at what was the best football player in the state of Virginia. So I didn't change them. Now, one thing that I get a lot of criticism about running kids to the cemetery in Gettysburg at 3 o'clock in the morning. Well, I might be crazy, young people, but I have never been stupid in my life to run some parent child through no swamp at 3 o'clock in the morning. I took him to the cemetery at 9 o'clock at night on a bus. So that's the type of thing that they changed in the movies. And you know, Coach Yost's daughter was a very brilliant, she was crazy as a bed bug, but she was a very brilliant child in sports and track and football and whatnot, but she was never on the field running around like a crazy animal most of the time. But these were the type of things that they changed. And Jerry Bruckheimer, the producer of the movie, flew me all the way to New York because he knew it was upset me when I see the movie and I see many of these things that they change. And he said, I want you to know that we have to change some things from true to in essence of. I didn't even know what in essence of meant. But he meant that we had to change things, he said, because true movies don't make money. I didn't know that. Based on a true movie makes money. So they change whatever they feel that they can change to bring people, make people excited, to bring them into, you know, into the theater. The real person of that film was Frankie Glasgow. The person that ran that last touchdown, but 12 seconds ago, his name was Frankie Glasgow. But because Rev, first of all, Disney couldn't find Frankie Glasgow to get his signature permission. So because Rev, who had lost his job to Sunshine, was demoted, they found a way to bring Rev back into the movie, and you know, because he was the starting quarterback, and they wrote a script where he could run the last play of the game. But I thought the movie Remember the Titans, young people, is a movie of a lifetime, but it's a movie. Let me thank you for this once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to be back here at TC again and to talk to you brilliant young people. And let's keep fighting to make TC the best football team, the best athletic team, the best academic team, and the best teachers like Mr. Eaton and the rest of you in the nation. Thank you and God bless you.
Well, on behalf of everyone here at TC, Coach, it's been great to have you back. We hope you'll come back again soon. It was a fascinating experience. It was an inspirational experience. So we're going to say goodbye now from the television studio at TC Williams High School. I'm Mark Eaton. Thank you for tuning in.